welcome to the September 26th meeting of the Hadley School Committee. Humira is traveling today. Roby is ill, so we have a quorum of three. Our first agenda item, approval of the minutes.
I had no questions.
Me neither.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes from August 29th, 2016 meeting.
Second it.
Thanks. Sure. You guys will be doing that a lot
apparently
tonight.
Apparently, really. We'll alternate.
We'll take turns.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Adjustments to the agenda. We have one member of the public here to talk to us about question two. So we'll move that in front of the presentation and discussion items, which is the bulk of our meeting today. And any other adjustments? We're on to the public comment period. Wow, huh?
Yeah. Well, thank you for the opportunity to address you on this question. As you may know, probably do know, question two is the ballot initiative that will come up on the November ballot regarding lifting the cap on the number of charter schools across the state. And the question would allow for, if it's passed, it would allow for 12 new charters every school, every year across the state forever. So that in 10 years there could be up to 120 new charters and on and on beyond that. In addition, it would allow for an unlimited number of those charters to open in any particular area or region, regardless of the impact of those schools on that school district. So there could be multiple charters opened in one school district, and even if that meant that an enormous amount of money was taken from the public schools in that area. So as a resident of Hadley and as a resident of Massachusetts, I, along with many others, am very concerned about this initiative. Regardless of how of anyone's feelings about particular charter schools or even charter schools in general, this initiative is written in a very, I believe, dangerous manner because of threat to funding for public education. Across the state, more than $450 million is already being taken from the public schools for charter education. And in Hadley, that figure is above $500,000 this year. That's an enormous amount of money already. This initiative would not close any existing charters. I mean, if the question is defeated, it would not close or affect any existing charter schools, but it would prevent the proliferation of those schools with this particular financing system where it's drawing from the public budget. So I'm here to request that the school committee in Hadley join with many, many others, I think over 100 now in the state, who have passed resolutions against question two. And I don't know if that's an unusual thing for these committees to be doing, to pass resolutions on public questions like that, but I think in this particular case, districts are finding it's so important and so threatening to the future of the public schools in their areas that they are putting forward this very public stand against the question. And I would really hope and encourage and urge you all as our representatives to do the same thing. As taxpayers, it is our money that would be used for these new charters. And these charters would not be accountable to you. You are our elected representatives. You are the people that we have chosen to represent us and to run our public schools. These charters would open. You would have nothing to say about it. You couldn't say no. You couldn't say yes. You couldn't say anything about it. And they would not be accountable to you in terms of governance. The governance is quite opaque. They are essentially privately managed schools. So I think it's important that the Hadley join with all the other boards across the state that have taken that position, and I urge you to do so. thank you for the chance to talk to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I didn't put discussion of a vote on this on the agenda because I knew Hugh Mara wasn't going to be here, but I forgot that, Heather, you're not here next month, are you?
No.
Okay. So we don't have this on the agenda to talk about this month, but we can. As I think I contacted each of you individually and asked that you all conduct your own research on the question. Do you want to talk about it now? Do you want me to put it onto the agenda for next month? Heather, you will not be here. Hugh Mara and Roby hopefully will.
I will not be here, but my preference is to put it on the agenda for next month, and I'd be happy to send my comments as an individual member of the committee, because when we spoke, I didn't understand that there was a research request, but more of an understanding of the approach to this.
Okay.
So
all right.
I think if we can push it to next month, but understanding that individually we need to bring our collective research to the table rather than a public presentation of a yes or a no side, that's the way we were going to proceed.
Okay. Good?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay. So we'll add it to the agenda for next month.
Okay.
Thank you for coming. You're welcome to stay. Annie loves spreadsheets, and we're about to just get a lot of spreadsheets and a lot of tables right now.
Yeah, I made for sure. I won't be offended. Well, I might be. So this is, yes, I do love spreadsheets. I love presentations on student learning. As you know, most of us know that our 2016 MCAS data, the embargo was lifted today. What I thought was important to do this evening was to do an overall presentation on student learning in the district. I think it's dangerous to ever focus simply on one measure as an indicator of whether or not students are learning well and how aligned our curriculum is. I also am very excited that as part of talking to you about our student performance and student growth over time, I get to introduce you to Rebecca DeBartolomeo, if you do not know her. She's our Title I reading teacher, or Title I teacher and reading teacher at Hadley Elementary School. And some of the data that you will see is from the Title I program. And Ms. DeBartolomeo and her students really just hit the ball out of the park. So just like I wanted to bring Ms. DeSotti before you, I also wanted you to see the wizard behind Title I, Ms. DeBartolomeo. So when we talk about student learning, we really try to refrain from saying things like, how do we do on that standardized test? Oh my gosh, what's the accountability rating? But we focus on these questions: how well are students learning, how effective are our interventions, and how relevant and aligned is our curriculum? And then we determine what types of data we might look at to answer these questions. So we decide what data we're going to use, we then derive meaning from that data analysis, and we think about the implications for professional development, for curriculum instruction and assessment. That's what the leadership team does. And of course, the school committee would use this analysis to inform resource allocation and policy development. And the kinds of data that we use, and I'm about to go through some data, to how we started looking at the question or responding to the question, how well are students learning and how effective are our interventions? So we're really concerned with how well students are learning overall, but you know in the district we've made it a priority to ensure that all students make progress. And we're particularly interested in identifying those students who may be at risk of not making progress at a level that's comparable to their peers, because they may face all kinds of obstacles to learning, whether that's a learning disability, whether that is economic disadvantagement. It could be a whole range of things. So we really look in our data to focus on those students for whom learning might be a challenge and say, how are we doing with those students? And that's why I'm going to start with Title I. So I sent this to you if you have devices, and I'll point things out because unfortunately this isn't a good color for I'm going to do these spreadsheets and I color them different colors, and then I'm so taken with my work, but undoubtedly the audience is not. So let me tell you what's up here. This is just a snapshot.
One second. Richard, yeah. Do we want to try to turn off the lights? Would that help?
I'm doing well with the lights.
Okay. All right.
Thanks. Okay. So changes in normal curve equivalency, or an NCE. The Title I program, if you're not familiar with it, is a, Linda's looking at me like, oh, here she
I just
goes.
Love that already.
Here she goes.
Curve.
So Title I is a federally funded program that is designed to provide schools with additional funding in order to help students that are considered disadvantaged. The students that are identified to receive support through Title I are students whose families might receive some sort of transitional assistance, students who are classified as delinquent, who have been neglected, who come from families who are economically disadvantaged. I think I got just about every group there. I might have missed a group. But so it's federal funds that go directly to the state, and then these are entitlement funds. They're not discretionary funds. We don't apply for these funds. We in Hadley do what's called school-wide interventions. So we don't have to match the dollars strictly for, a student doesn't have to meet the federal criteria. We're also allowed to do school-wide interventions. And so a child may not come from a family of economic disadvantage or may not be delinquent, neglected, and may very well be receiving Title I because we have school-wide interventions. All Title I programs use something called normal curve equivalencies to measure student growth. A normal curve equivalency is similar to a percentile ranking. The only difference is it was designed for Title I because there's equal intervals between scorers, which is not true in percentile rankings. So the distance between 22 and 23 and 23 and 24 is the same in an NCE. It is not in percentile rankings. An NCE and percentile rankings are the same at 150 and 99. So Title I says, and this is normal curve equivalency changes on the Gates-McGinnity. Is that, that's correct, right? On the Gates-McGinnity. And what Title I is looking for is an increase, they consider their own language, an educationally important increase. So they don't use statistically significant, but educationally important increase to be 11 points or greater. So here's a snapshot with no student identifying information of a chunk of our Title I students. One of whom we see a pre and post from 2015 to spring of 2016, so a fall, spring, pre-post, of a point gain of 34 points of NCE. The next one is just over 31, then almost 28, 21.6, 20.5, 20.4, 19.1. So why am I pointing this out to you? This is one of the indicators that we use to say how well are students learning and how effective are our interventions. Title I provides very targeted, highly specialized interventions. Mr. Bartolomeo is certified in Orton-Gillingham, and she's also certified as a reading teacher reading specialist. And therefore, she's highly skilled in delivering reading instruction. So this is a specific intervention, and we think we have some data to indicate that it's effective.
Well, this just got a little tricky. Excuse me.
So Annie, I'm sorry, was that all Title I students?
No, it was not all Title I students. So what we found is that we have, of all of our Title I students, let me make sure I wrote this down, of all of our Title I students, we had 17 of those students who had what the NCE considers educationally important, so an increase of over 12. We had another 9 students who had an increase, but it was less than 11. And then we had 9 students for whom there was very limited change on NCE. In a couple of cases, we did see a decline in NCE, but when I show you reading comprehension, they all made gains in reading comprehension.
How do you explain that?
Well, I'll let Mr. Bartolomeo think about that, or would you like to explain it now?
We also have to think that this is a snapshot, and it is one test again.
Oh, yeah, true.
And it's timed, which is a really important factor, especially with students who are needing a little bit more support in reading.
The time factor could be a big hindrance with students. So,
thanks.
Yep.
Gates-McGinnity also does reading, grade equivalencies in reading, and there are a few subtests in reading, correct, in addition to just their overall. And those subtests?
So Gates-McGinnity for grade 1 focuses on decoding and comprehension. Grade 2, decoding word knowledge, which is the beginning of vocabulary and comprehension. And then grades 3 through 6, it's vocabulary and comprehension.
And what we have in our 28 students in the pre and post is 15 students had grade equivalency gains of greater than a grade. 3 had a one grade, roughly a one grade increase, and 10 had between some months and one grade. And in some cases, you see the student at the top, that's a change of four grades in reading comprehension. So we also have some students who did extraordinarily well, had tremendous gains in Title I. And we also used a developmental reading assessment in Title I. And Rebecca, would you mind talking about what that assessment is?
Sure. This is a one-on-one test. It takes about 25 to 30 minutes to complete. Students read a leveled story. They read a first page of the story, and then they have to predict what's going to happen in the remainder of the story. And then they finish the book silently and have to retell the story details in sequential order without the book, so it's from memory. Follow-up questions are then asked of the students, and then a running record is taken from a page. The students read aloud a page, and I document miscues, so errors while reading, and also notice their reading behaviors, whether or not they're repeating passages over and over, or if they're not fluently reading the story accurately. And it's really, you want to get a score of 94% or higher and have adequate comprehension in order to be considered competent at that particular level.
And what you're looking at on the screen are not percentile rankings, so don't, when she said 94%, does that mean these students here, I can do this for you, are receiving 12%. These levels also correspond with grade level spans. So 12, I can't remember, might be
first grade.
And
30 would be beginning of third grade.
Beginning of third grade. So you see a change from first grade to beginning of third grade and a difference of 18 in the DRA reading level. So we saw gains, as I said, in reading comprehension for all students in Title I. And what did MCAS tell us about our students in Title I? Now, our Title I students are not separately reported because it's not a large enough cohort group. But we also saw, and this is important, these are the kinds of things that we asked ourselves, okay, what is MCAS telling us? Because we certainly see the lighter green are the student growth percentiles for Title I students, all Title I students, in ELA, and the darker green is in math. So we do have about a third of our students in high or very high growth. We also, though, have about a third of our students down in low or very low growth when it comes to ELA. But again, I would point out that this is useful information. It's very useful information. But what MCAS isn't indicating to us, because it is, in most cases, the anomaly, it isn't indicating to us that students are not growing, progressing, and learning. And that's further supported by some of the access data, which you've seen for last year. I showed you 2 years worth of data, and now we have a third year worth of data. And access is the data that we use to assess the progress of English language learners. Before I go to access, that question of how well are students learning and how effective are interventions, you know, the district has invested heavily in tiered interventions at the elementary level to help students to read more fluently and competently. This is grade one. Last year I showed you benchmark one and benchmark two. Again, we're trying to get as many students as we can in this green. If students score in this green area, DIBELS, which is a dynamic indicator of basic early literacy skills, believes that if you score in the green, you have an 80 to 90% chance of scoring, meeting successive grade level benchmarks. And if you're in the red, that goes down to about 10 to 20%. So clearly what we see in grade one, what we would hope for is we go from not having competent readers to having the majority, about 87% of the class scoring in the green. You saw this last year too. The green DIBELS sets out something on the DIBELS composite score. They have a goal, like an aggregate score for the class, that's that green bar. The purple score is what the students, the class, entire grade one actually scored. So you can see in every case, except for the beginning of the year, that our students actually exceeded the goal set by DIBELS. And so these graphs also, we have them for grade level two. The green stayed relatively stable, but the good news is that from benchmark two to benchmark three, we saw a decrease in students who would need intensive support in red from 19 to just about 12%.
And Dibbles ends in grade two?
No, we have grade three data also, and we may be doing it for grade four this year, or no, Dr. Wickman, are we? Yes, so we'll extend it to grade four because we've extended the tiered interventions this year into fourth grade. Grade two also, the purple being the actual benchmark scores from last year, you can see they exceeded goal on all benchmarks. In grade three, a slight increase in students who would only need core support, and a decrease, a slight decrease in students who would need intensive support. But grade three, whoops, grade three students, the class composite score, the actual score exceeds the goal set by Dibbles on all three benchmarks. So I go back to, we pay close attention to, and student growth percentiles are some of the most important information for us when we look at MCAS because we want to see changes in performance. So it's certainly an important indicator, and we use that information to design, the principals will talk about this, to try to design very intensive and individualized interventions for students. But we also have additional information that tells us that students are acquiring literacy skills. Of course, MCAS would only be in grade three of this group that you saw, but on the Title I data, many of those students are in MCAS-tested grades. This is data about ELLs, English language learners, excuse me. Again, this is Ms. Desadi, is our English as a second language teacher, and like Ms. DeBartolomeo, just consistently hits the ball out of the park. So the green, where there is one, is 2014, their overall proficiency level in English language. Six is the highest you can get, at which point you exit out of the English as a second language program. You can see some of the growth. The red bar is 2015, so this student had between 1 and 2 and is above 4 the following year. We see tremendous growth. And even where levels are a little bit lower overall, we're still seeing growth for all students and sometimes really significant growth. Again, these students aren't reported out separately in our MCAS scores because the cohort isn't large enough. And the student growth percentile, I'll show you the MCAS student growth percentile for English language learners and formerly English language learners. But this is really powerful. You saw these red bars last year. That was the student growth percentile for 2015 in ACCESS. That's the test that measures one's English proficiency skills. The blue is 2016. The state considers between 80 and 100 very high. And I should remember, and I don't, I feel like it's like almost like a normal curve distribution. And so maybe 2%, very few students are expected overall to have very high between 80 and 100 SGP. And you can really see, I mean, it's quite powerful. And the lowest SGP that one of our ELLs has is still moderate growth. So there's no low growth, and some of these growth numbers, 99, 89, 89, 99, 97, it's just outrageous in a very good way. And MCAS, here we saw some nice student growth. Again, this is not reported for us because our cohort is too small. We saw some nice growth even on the MCAS for English language learners, formerly English language learners. This is not all of the ELLs and the students who are learning English in the district, only those who would have a growth percentile. You see these asterisks down here? We have, this would be low growth. And the asterisk is because the students scored proficient on MCAS. So their growth was low on MCAS, that can happen. If you're advanced or proficient, it's more difficult to demonstrate higher growth than, not always, but than if you are moving on the continuum of needs improvement to the next level. So still scored proficient even though they had low growth. And here, we may have seen, in some cases, lower achievement on MCAS, but students are definitely learning. So the questions we want to answer, yes, we are absolutely concerned with how our students perform on statewide standardized tests, but that's not our driving question. Our driving question is how well are students learning and how effective are our interventions. Support for English language learners is an intervention, and we would say that the data indicates that it's pretty effective. So our SGP by grade level on the MCAS, again, where we pay the most attention, you can see where we'll be focusing our efforts. We have This is moderate, actually, this is considered high growth. 40 to 60 is moderate growth, or 40 to 59. 60 and above is high growth. So that's considered high growth on the low, high end. Moderate growth, almost very high growth, and 80 is very high. So very good growth in sixth grade math. Moderate, high, we have a low in ELA fourth grade in terms of growth, and moderate growth. Here, we have very low growth in grade 8 math. And I know that Mr. Beck's going to speak a little bit about some of the work that Hopkins is already undertaking to try to take a look at what factors might be fostering or inhibiting the factors that might be fostering or inhibiting student achievement, but also he'll speak a little bit about the kind of curriculum analysis that's underway at Hopkins. So really important because it's where the rubber meets the road. Grade 10, which determines whether or not students meet the competency determination and graduate from high school. So 34 out of 36 students, or 95%, scored advanced or proficient in English language arts. It's really important to point out that 34 out of 34 standard paper and pencil test takers scored advanced or proficient. We have students who take what's called an alternate assessment. They absolutely demonstrate many times growth. But that progress on the performance level translates into warning failing. So 34 out of 34 standard paper pencil test takers advanced or proficient on the MCATs. In math, our performance is not quite as high as our English performance. Also important to point out that 30 out of 36 scored advanced or proficient. We have 34 students in math who take a standard paper pencil MCAS assessment. Of those students, 30 scored advanced or proficient, and 4 still, they passed, but they have some work to do. But we also did an analysis, and it doesn't relieve us of our obligations to individual students. It just informs how we approach the problem. So when we analyze, which you can do with the spreadsheets that I love that the state gives me, I make tables, I look at it all day long, these guys love it, not really. So what we can do is we can sort by years in district. So what we found is that the students, that if a student is with us for 4 or more years at this level, they're scoring advanced or proficient. And how does that inform our decision? Again, does not absolve us of any obligation to an individual student. But what it tells us is that it may be less of a curriculum alignment problem, and the important thing for us to do is to really strongly intervene with the individual student. So it's about how you think about the problem and the next action that you take. So don't say, oh my gosh, everything's falling apart in math at this level because it's not at this level. We want everybody at advanced and proficient, or that's the expectation. But we find that there is a correlation between years and districts and performance. And so then that helps us decide, okay, what kinds of things do we need to do to make sure students are well supported when they come into our district, perhaps later. So how do we align curriculum? Remember the first two questions: how well are students learning, how effective are the interventions, and then how relevant and aligned is our curriculum? So we use something called Edwin Analytics, which is a whole data dashboard that the Department of Ed provides us. And the schools they do test item analysis, they look at results by standard, they look at the common assessments that they have, benchmark assessments, maybe our finals, and then they determine next steps to improve curriculum instruction and interventions. And I will start with the elementary, if I may, and Brian, you can wrap it up. And I'm going to turn this off unless you have questions about the data that was up there. Because Lord forbid that the lamp, I run through a lamp.
So as Dr. McKenzie indicated, we do a lot of looking at children, not only through assessment, but through their work. And so some of these are data points, and then we try to connect them. And last week, we as a faculty took a deeper dive into our results and tried to look at some of the item analysis and see where is it a curriculum alignment? Are we missing the boat on something? And some of the things that came from that meeting Our third grade noted that math was an area of increase, and we had just done a year of interventions for them. So we noted that that probably was having a positive impact. A little too soon to say for sure, but it was a nice result to see. Some of our other grades looked at some of the items and said, oh, the kids struggled with the ones that we addressed early in the year, or, oh my gosh, those are ones we covered in June after. So they didn't even have those skills going into the test. So that's just one way of looking at it. But this Thursday, we have, and Wednesday and Thursday, we have data days. And what we do is the teachers get together and they look at our in-house assessments and align those with the state tests, as well as trying to cluster and look at the skills that kids have and organize them in ways that we can address those skills specifically for them. So Rebecca will be part of those data days, and our teachers get together and map out a lot of many of the slides you saw. They take a look at that and pull that together to create support groups for students around the areas that they might need additional support. So we are addressing it in a variety of different ways.
So today at the high school, we had our first set of department meetings, which is really the place where, with their colleagues, they're able to meet vertically. And I'm sorry, I went with the math department today, and we did an item analysis to start. It provides us a great opportunity for us to look at the questions that our kids were successful on or not as successful as compared to other students in the state of Massachusetts. So it gives us a great gauge in terms of where our kids should be on grade level. In mathematics, one of the things that we focused on first was looking at open response and short answer questions and identifying those places. For example, we saw some anomalies on the eighth grade test where we looked at the types of questions where we had a fairly significant number of kids who didn't even write anything down on one of the answers, yet we were very clearly able to identify places in the curriculum over the course of the year last year where that particular topic was addressed. It was actually something that was fairly frequent. So in terms of problem solving, that becomes a matter of us looking at our instructional and assessment practices and whether or not we're providing enough opportunity for students to have the chance to tackle those types of problems with more complex and sophisticated answers on a more regular basis. One of the other interesting things that had popped up was really seeing the places in 7th, 8th, and as well as 10th grade where students had made huge growth. And looking back at what it was that changed about educational circumstances, instructional practices, assessments, or other support type interventions that we believe led to that, and then being able to match those particular cases up with students with similar characteristics who are now entering those grades. Mm-hmm. And of course, having the opportunity to meet vertically today, even though we were just looking at item analysis for about an hour and a half, and going through each of those questions. We didn't do a great deal of problem solving. We just sort of threw out, what do we think happened here that was positive? What do we think happened here that might have been missing? Next stages for us really are to pull out the curriculum, to take a look at some areas where we had done very well and have historically done very well. Those might be places where especially if kids have a great deal of vertical exposure to that type of concept, particularly in mathematics, that we may not need to spend as much time and can give more time in class and to other types of activities in class, which would cultivate more understanding and therefore have students on questions in the future, or this incoming graduating class, say coming into the eighth grade, for example, will have the opportunity to have more exposure to those questions because, you know, we can shrink up those areas that students perform really well in and devote more class time to the areas that our students need more time on those topics.
Remind me what's happening with standardized testing in this coming spring?
I'm glad that you asked that question. So in grade 10, stays with MCATs, and now that's through 2019. Is that right?
I can't remember. It is.
Is it through 2019 now?
Yeah. I believe so, yeah.
So with MCAS, and we, it's still in the spring, some sort of, this isn't a very good statistical term, hodgepodge, because they will not have completed, they have a contract with the creation of MCAS 2.0, so we're in between MCAS 2.0 where we are now, so it'll probably look quite similar to what we saw last year. Grades 4 and 8 must take computer-based testing. And the administrative leadership team and Mike Duffy, we've been talking about the other grades as an option. And so we have the capacity to do online testing, but we've had some discussion about does it make sense to necessarily do it all at once? What's challenging is that we know that in several districts that had PARC, found this out, that we know that there are going to be some things that probably prevent us from seeing students' true performance level, namely their typing skills, and that's a challenge for us.
So one of the things, for example, that we didn't discuss today, we mentioned it and said it was another topic, and it has, you know, the same similar implications in that in order for our students to be in the eighth grade to be prepared to take both math and ELA online, we have to have our assessments be similar as they're going through the year. We can't just have our students come in and take that. So it's going to change our assessment and instructional practices out of necessity in both the fourth and eighth grade. So we're going to have to be doing some outside professional development, bring that information back in and find it really in short order so that we can get our teachers and our current students some exposure to what those sample tests are going to look like online,
right,
and then weave that back through our instructional and assessment practices within the context of the course so that the MCAS test itself is just not the first time that they have the opportunity to work on that platform.
And I want to be really clear about something. I mean, particularly in both schools, as you know, Helping Hearts and the school committee has invested heavily in technology. Mm-hmm. Students are using computers regularly in learning tasks and performance tasks. But it's a whole different ball game when it's MCAS. I mean, their anxiety level goes through the roof. So it isn't as though we're implying that, oh my goodness, our students have not been learning with or demonstrating proficiency with technology. We've never done this, and that's all new. That's not the case at all. But it feels very different. Just as they write and read every single day, but on the day that it's MCAS, all of a sudden that feels very different, demonstrating one's mastery and proficiency. So we do want to be purposeful about assessing students in some maybe more mock high-stakes environments with technology.
So these data become available tomorrow? Are they going to be in the paper and such?
So the embargo was lifted at 4:30 today, and there should be, the Gazette reached out to me today. I indicated that I would talk to them when the embargo was lifted, and the Gazette did not call me back today. So there'll be... there will be data, I imagine. Difficult in some cases, difficult to make sense of it. You had about 2/3 of the schools in Massachusetts, districts in Massachusetts who did PARC. You had roughly about 1/3, maybe it's a little bit more, maybe it's more like
60-40.
Yeah, 60-40 split. And so I'm struggling with the statewide comparisons. I had said to both principals, I mean, useful, but I wouldn't put too much stock there because I'm not quite sure how that works. We'll see what's in how
well you reports. You know, your love of data, it does seem like it's going to be harder to key in on the interventions because the test is changing. So your beginning presentation of how are we helping our kids mm-hmm. learn is more important than the test results.
So certainly just with the MCAS, because that is changing.
Right.
We think the MCAS is important, and our goal is to derive meaning from it.
Right.
We say we don't want to be data-rich and information-poor and just have a bunch of numbers and we're not making meaning out of it. So we do think the MCAS is important. We're trying to say, okay, what is it telling us? I will say that I'm grateful that our district stayed with the MCAS, because one thing that folks may not realize, Dr. Wickman can certainly speak to this because she was in a PARC district, is that the state, if you're a park district, you do not get item analysis. I can't remember what the reason is for that. I don't think they had sufficient capacity to store all of that and give that information. And that, to me, I certainly understand preparing students for park and having them take a similar test. But what frustrates me about that is if you're going to, I mean, these are days and hours of stressful testing for children. And if you are not going to get data back that you can actually use to evaluate your curriculum and inform your instruction, which is standards not analysis and test item analysis, that strikes me as almost, it's unconscionable, not from a district who made that choice, because there are good reasons to do that. But I'll just say from the state's perspective, it's a lot of time that students put into this. Mm-hmm. So I'm grateful that we're able to get the data that we have. The downside is we're not held harmless in accountability levels. I should say the bottom line is we're a level 2 district. We remain a level 2 district because there's still a gap in performance between high needs students and all students in our district. And because the district is whatever one or more schools is. So if one school, and both schools are level 2 right now, but even if one were a level 1, we are, our designation is whatever the lowest performing school is. So our percentage of participation, over 95%, but we still need to work on closing the gap between high needs and all learners. But I am grateful. We're not held harmless, but at least we have data that we can use to make meaningful decisions about curriculum and instruction.
Annie, do you remember, was PARC, was that assessment an adaptive assessment?
I don't remember.
That may be why they didn't release the item analysis, just in that not everybody takes the same items.
Adaptive meaning the question changes as you get it
what
right.
You get,
the next question changes with right or wrong.
So part of taking the test would have been, and I have no judgment on this,
if it was
asking,
adaptive, that
if it's adaptive, so it's building, it's to help them construct the test.
Yeah, right? you basically, if you got it wrong, then you get typically a slightly easier item than the next one. And it can help shorten the length of the test, ultimately.
Is that the way exams like the nursing boards and other exams work in a similar fashion? Or?
If they're called a computer adaptive test, like a CAT, which NCLEX may be the nursing one.
I don't believe PARC was.
Okay, yeah.
I think it had more to do with it being part of a consortium. So there were 11 different states taking it. And so to release the items and to... have it aligned.
It's a huge undertaking.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah. So,
and they
did want to, I think, bank some of those, most of those questions and not release them because they couldn't generate new questions as quickly. But that's part of it. So I think that's also part of why Massachusetts chose to go to MCAS 2.0 mm-hmm. versus stay with PARC because we don't get enough information to help us inform our curriculum decisions and our instructional decisions.
Don't and won't? Is that?
I think with MCAS 2.0, they will provide at least mm-hmm. some.
It's probably an expectation in the RFP, I would imagine.
Right.
That the designer has to do it, that they will.
So I'm just curious, if when the Gazette calls tomorrow, they ask, what do you think they're going to ask about, and what would you say?
So essentially what I presented here this evening is that these are the places where we pay most attention. First of all, what we use MCAS for. It was not designed ever to evaluate educators. So anytime I'm asked questions about what does this tell you about teacher performance or do you take any action, it's not a valid use of MCAS. And Ron Hamilton, Steve Cerisi, and others at UMass would say the same thing. That MCAS... It certainly does tell us something, a snapshot about student achievement. We don't dismiss that. But its greatest utility, we believe, is in helping us analyze and align the curriculum. And so that slide where we look at where we saw the lowest growth, as we look then for what have we seen, we started to even do a cohort analysis. So how were those students performing when they were in 7th grade, when they were in 6th grade? And what is this telling us about our curriculum? So we'll focus our efforts where we saw the lowest growth. Growth is really important to us. Acknowledging some cases you get low growth because your performance is so high. A student who's been advanced is going to have a growth percentile of 3 sometimes if they've been scoring 262s, 265s. So that's what we'll use it for. We'll focus on the growth percentiles. We will try to figure out, we use that data to try to figure out if MCAS is the outlier or if it's part a comprehensive picture that's telling us that there's something that's not working and something that is that's wrong. Pleased to maintain a level two district when, again, we weren't held harmless. Like every district that went to PARP was held harmless, and we will get an accountability level. So essentially, what you folks heard is what the paper would hear. This is how we'll focus our efforts and why we'll focus them there. And our work has really been around sorting, which is a nice thing about being a small school. So when we get the spreadsheets on MCAS and format them as a table and then sort them by how students have done over the past few years, if we see any sort of decline in performance, then our focus is to go in and say, okay, who is that child's teacher right now? What are we going to do? That's some of the work that Brian has been doing today. I also had a chance to speak with his English department chair, Ms. Camuso, the same thing. Like, and we're small enough that we can say, wow, here we have some students who are scoring in the high proficient category, and scores above 250, and certainly, you know, advanced as well within their reach. So on both ends, how can we support students? How can we stretch and how can we support? And that's how we use the data. And that we look at, that's really important for the Gazette, for any newspaper to understand that I don't want to talk about just MCAS. I mean, I just don't care. I care about how students are learning. And MCAS tells me something about that. When I look at individual students, it does. Mm-hmm. But there are all these other things that we look at, too, to try to determine what skills we need to help students develop. And MCAS tells us a lot about how aligned our curriculum is.
I think taking that kind of multiple measures approach is mm-hmm. smart, especially with us being a small district. Mm-hmm. I think, too, your point earlier about looking at years in the district mm-hmm. for the student, the particular example you cited, mm-hmm. that that's also important in that you're not, you're digging a little deeper in order to not just, you know, realign or throw something out that you think is not working, but mm-hmm. more focusing in on a strategy that may be more related to a transition of, you know, a mm-hmm. student coming into the district or not having been here enough mm-hmm. years to necessarily become acclimated to the curriculum and coverage.
Yeah, I think it would be fair to say, even when you look at, which I have the post-secondary data presentation, don't worry, I've got a couple months off, but that our post-secondary outcomes we know are good. They're higher than state averages. And when I look at that years in districts, I just want to underscore for the viewing audience that we in no way absolve ourselves of our obligation for a student who hasn't been here for a long time.
Right.
But it would just, to your point, we're not going to say, wow, our curriculum's in horrible shape. If 34 out of 34 standard test takers, advanced or proficient in MCAS, ELA, and 34 out of 34 pass in math, but we know that 30, if you've been here four or more years, you scored advanced or proficient in MCAS. So it just mm-hmm. tells us that we want to, if somebody comes into our district, we want to kind of zero in and let's make sure that their experience will prepare them for what they need to achieve.
Question? I understand the data that you presented, but mm-hmm. how much effect does students moving in and moving out in school choice students have on that data?
So school choice students would not have necessarily an effect just by virtue of being a school choice student. There's no data to indicate that school choice has any sort of effect. We don't have, that's called the move in and move out in districts, is referred to as churn. And we don't have that in Hadley, a lot of it. Like districts such as Chicopee, Springfield, and Holyoke have very, very high churn rates. We don't. But as I said, we just look more at how long you've been with us in Hadley Public Schools, and there does seem to be a relationship. If you've been with us a while, we are, I sound like a commercial now, stay with us and you'll pass.
All school choice students have to come in the beginning of the year. Can they come in midterm or anything?
They can. I didn't know that.
That's another question. So that would sort of disrupt the data too.
But let's be careful because there's nothing in the data to indicate that school choice students are in any way performing at a worse rate or in some sort of alarming rate than students who are not school choice. So a school choice student can be in our district for a very long time. They can choice in K, 1, 2, 3, and stay with us. So it's really important to be clear. There is nothing in the data to indicate that a school choice student performs, has lower growth or lower achievement than a resident. It's more about, often it's about school stability. And this is common across education. It's not just around MCAS. We're taught in special education that when you see, sometimes in younger grades, when you see an IQ score, that's an ability test that's very, very low, the first question you're supposed to ask is how many schools has a child attended? So school interruption, it's not about choice or not choice, but school interruption can have a negative impact on student achievement and growth.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right. You're off the hook for
that. Was really good data.
I want more spreadsheets.
Yeah, it wasn't enough spreadsheets.
Don't reinforce. Really. Don't carefully wish for.
So speaking of that, we're on to the superintendent evaluation. Annie and I were laughing the other day that we have not voted Annie off the island.
True.
Be back next month.
Yep.
Yep.
So for the people that don't know, the way the superintendent evaluation now works is the Department of Education gives us goals to evaluate. We decided to choose four of the goals. The Department of Education gives us the requirement that we must do a formative rating of unsatisfactory, needs improvement, proficient, or exemplary for each of the goals. And then we create our own impact measures and timelines. We did kind of a two-year impact measures and timelines, and in that, the categories of evaluation are did not meet, some progress, significant progress, met or exceeded. So Annie had, Dr. McKenzie or Annie in this case, Dr. Yeah. McKenzie had four goals. The first was instructional leadership, which is promoting the learning and growth of students. The impact measures in large part talked about how we did on MCAS, how the district did. So in goal one, Annie got proficient in the goal and some progress in the impact measures because the MCAS scores. For those of you, Paul, you weren't here, I don't think, but when Annie proposed her impact measures to us 2 years ago, we said, wow, those are really aggressive goals, really aggressive. And she suggested that it be a one-year goal. Mm-hmm. And we suggested maybe that's a little aggressive and that should be a two-year goal. Mm-hmm. So.
It's just this feeling, like, and I told you so a moment. So yes, you were correct.
So we got really good on that one by guessing that was aggressive. But where, so the MCAS didn't meet the impact measures that we created, but we do know that we have the DIBL scores and all of the tier one intervention that show significant improvement. We have a Hopkins graduation rate and a college enrollment and college retention rate that exceeds state and national averages. We have more kids in AP classes at Hopkins than state and national averages, so that while we didn't meet the MCAS goals, we met several other goals, and that our ask for next year is that if we're going to keep this as one of our goals, which I assume we would, is that the impact measures include more than just MCAS, so that we are looking at the holistic process of education. So the second goal was professional culture. It's really how the staff are feeling about the school environment. And we have, we gave Annie proficient and met on this goal. And one of the things that we were most impressed with is that when Department of Education came out with the teacher evaluation tool, it was aggressive would be a term I would use about how the Department of Education required teachers to be assessed and to manage how they did, and the districts that had massive notebooks of teachers documenting everything they did. And one of the great things that Annie did was really to calm those waters and really talk about what are we here for? We're here to teach our kids and to make sure they're doing the best they can. So created a handbook on the evaluation, created quarterly newsletters, has regular meetings with her evaluation team, and uses data. Yeah. But one thing that we talked about is that the data can be hard for mm-hmm. people to understand, and that a goal for our next round will be to think about how we can qualitatively express the quantitative data, either through storytelling or highlighting and spotlighting teacher achievements, etc. Mm-hmm. So figuring out how to do that. Family and community engagement was the third goal, and again, we gave Annie proficient and met, and I think this is what we hear the most about the improvement of family and community engagement since Annie has joined the district with her weekly emails and attendance at every concert, most sporting events, always in the schools, going to town department head meetings, so making sure that we have good relationships between the town and the schools, addressing criticisms and complaints quickly and directly. And our goal for the next time is really to tackle how we can constructively and positively use social media, since Facebook has kindly created a Facebook page for us, and to get more press coverage, especially positive, maybe only positive. And then finally, the last one is management and operations, and that one is really how is Annie using our resources to implement appropriate curriculum, staffing, and scheduling? And I realize that my comments really didn't go as far as they should have. What we talked about in the evaluation was the implementation of the PBIS and active bystander and the quantifiable reduction in disciplinary actions, especially on the bus, but also in the schools. But what I forgot to put in this was really all of the work that you've helped us with talking to the tri-board and educating the town and the select board about how the budget works and the importance of the budget and the relationship between a good school and a strong school budget to property values and revenues coming into the town. And that all of that is so important as the town moves forward with how we manage our financial future as a town and a school. So your overall rating was proficient and met, and we thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. You have to vote it, I believe, but I'll just need to, for the department, it's actually the summative, because it's the end of the 2 year and I'll do new goals. So
what did I call it?
Formative, but that's okay.
You call it summative in the agenda item.
Yes.
No, I didn't in my...
So just know you're in the document.
So gotcha. Close.
That's okay.
So
just
close.
Know I'm going to change it for the department.
Yes. Yes.
Possibly make summative. The comment before you vote in that area.
Are you trying to get me fired, Tom?
No.
Are you trying to vote on the island? No.
Simply enhance what the school committee said. We get information back all the time from what the school is doing through our department heads, and you get all A pluses. Our police chief and fire chief working with you for the safety of our students, our highway superintendent now getting our kids here in the winter time, dealing with you, and everybody tells us in the town hall working with the treasurer and accountant how accessible she is. That's the big thing. She always finds time for anybody that has a question for her, and that's a big asset, pulling the town all together and working together for a common goal. So I agree with you 100% with your ratings.
Thank you very much, Dawn. Thank you. And I will come clean and say I'm accessible at town hall because they have some of the best candy.
Thank you.
So we need to accept, endorse, approve. What verb would you like to use?
Approve the summative superintendent evaluation, is that correct?
Yep.
I'll second that vote, or do we vote and say yay?
Well, you just had to second it, so that was
good.
I'll second
the motion for a vote.
Okay. Wait, did that just happen that I have to now have the vote?
All in favor.
Yeah.
But I mean, all in favor. Did we just only make a motion to make a motion?
We made a motion to vote, and I seconded the motion.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Sorry. I didn't want to have a motion that was just making a motion. Do you know what I mean?
Got it.
Okay. We're on to personnel report.
Very little to report. We have our occupational therapist on staff now, and we have hired an educational support professional at Hopkins Academy in special education.
Awesome. Thank you. We're on to our financials.
Yes. Another fun and exciting thing.
I know.
Spreadsheets.
More numbers.
More numbers. Mark Chaffee will send his apologies, but he is home with the flu this evening, so that's why he's not here with me.
So's Roby.
He and I worked on the FY17 budget. As you know, what traditionally happens once the new fiscal year comes into play is then you've got to take a look at how the lines might have shifted from when you proposed the budget. Obviously, the bottom line is in alignment with what was voted at annual town meeting, but there were some shifts in some of the lines, basically due to hires, people who were hired and then replaced at different levels, and causing some of those shifts. Also some shifts because of changes in grant alignment, particularly with the kindergarten grant not being funded by the Commonwealth this year. So those things have taken place so that everything is covered as it should be, and that's why some of those lines may look a little different than when we saw it last spring. We seem to be well on pace with a good spending plan at this point. Now that the budget is actually in the budget software, we'll resume the weekly reports to everybody within the district so people can keep an eye on what's going on with all of that. Grants-wise, we're still in the process of applying for grants. We have not finished all of them yet. We've had some shifts in some of our grant amounts. Obviously, the kindergarten grant, which was $17,671 last year, is zero this year, so that was absorbed into the local. Title I was down a little bit, just shy of $300, so not a whole lot. Title IIA, which is the teacher quality grant, was down about $400. The special education grant was up by $1,700. Circuit breaker was down, but again, that's based on, you know, who's in district and who's getting what kinds of services. And there are other grants that are yet to be filed because either we haven't got the applications or people are in progress doing that. So that's where we are with grants. I have gotten some balances from the town accountant with regard to where things stand as of July 1, so we're analyzing those numbers as well and trying to take a look at that. As a matter of fact, starting next week, I'm going to be shifting days, and Hadley, instead of being here Monday and Thursday, I'll be here Monday and Wednesday, and the town accountant happens to be in on Wednesday, so we're actually going to have a face-to-face meeting next Wednesday so that he and I can talk about some things, and particularly so I can get my head wrapped around what he's saying are final balances for revolving accounts so I know, you know, where things stand and we can keep a good track of things moving forward.
Okay.
The audit is when? Do we know?
Usually in the early spring, late winter, early spring is usually when auditors come. Mr. Desjardins is going to work with me on filing the end of the year report. I got an extension from Jay Sullivan. I said, hi, I'm new here. Can we have 30 days, please? And he was kind enough to do that. So Chris and I are going to get together, not this weekend, but the following weekend, and just go through things. Because obviously he has his head wrapped around the 16 budget in ways that I don't. So we'll get to work on that and get it done.
Awesome. Thank you. Is that all you have for us?
No. Something that was passed
we have the up. 5-year capital plan.
Right.
Some changes?
Yes. The two biggest changes were in the area of technology. There's been mostly a little bit of an addition, about $2,500 after I talked with Mike Duffy about the numbers, and also a shift in how the money was going to be spent or what we were asking for. Originally it was $75,000 for hardware and $65,000 for infrastructure. We were able to, at the end of FY16, get a little infrastructure done, so that got taken off
the list, and so therefore the hardware is up a little bit and the infrastructure ask is down, and altogether it's about $2,500 more. I did check with Diane Zach with regard to the serving lines in the cafeteria and the drains. After talking to her, we increased that by about $1,000. That's a couple of years out, so again, that could be adjusted as we get closer to that time. So those were the big changes.
Thank you.
So now on this, I'm not sure what point do we edit it, because the athletic fields is not what we're talking about currently, especially phase one.
Oh, right. We should fix that. Yeah. Yep. So we want, what do we want to do? We want to take projected costs. What, we don't even know at this point, right?
No, that's our next step is to...
So do we want to say projected cost TBD, but year one, 2017, is $15,000?
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah, that's good.
So the $500,000 becomes TBD and projected cost. This becomes $15,000.
Yeah.
In year one.
Did we ever get any bids, Annie? You and I talked about this the other day on the elementary school air conditioners.
Judy has done a whole bunch of work. She is
lucky
your font
you.
Of wisdom. I am not the font.
Based on some work that has been done here recently, we got an estimate of about $10,000 to $12,000 per classroom to do the heat pump kind of thing, where the unit's outside and the compressor's outside and the unit comes inside. There are 31 classrooms right now, and looking at the high side of that, we're talking about $372,000. Pat Bell's office was, I guess, at one time also a classroom, so if you were going to add that into the mix, that could be another, say, $12,000. So you'd be looking at $384,000. You always want to have a contingency for the unexpected, so I think $400,000 is probably a reasonable number.
So, Judy, did you... a couple of questions. Is there an efficiency to do it all at once, or could we do it a small segment at a time?
You could do it in small in phases. You could phase it in. One of the issues that oftentimes I will caution folks about is with regard to medically fragile students, that if you air condition some rooms and you don't air condition others, and it's like, you air condition the first grade classroom, but you don't air condition the music room or the art room, are you denying them potentially access to that part of the curriculum? So that's something to be a little bit cautionary about. The other thing, too, is that obviously if you do it all at once, you're probably going to pay less upfront than you would if you did it over 2 or 3 years, because every year there's going to be some sort of increase, whether it's labor or the actual units themselves. So
realistically, we're looking at, let's say, it's pretty accurate, up to $400,000.
Chris DeJardin deserves some credit.
That was a good guess.
Yes, he does.
Yeah. We would be looking to where to get these monies.
So these are on the special town meeting warrant. So special town meeting, there is one warrant article to restore the $75,000 that was cut from the FY17 budget.
Right.
There's another warrant article that still reads, Judy, at the $140,000, which is fine. The technology articles still read at $140,000 rather than the $142,500.
Yeah.
And then, but the fields reads at $500,000. So certainly we could tell them that that would be adjusted down to $15,000. So these are currently sitting in the warrant, all of these things. But not in the warrant. Yes, in the warrant for special town meeting.
Did you get a copy of the new warrant? Are they still there? I didn't get a chance to open it today.
Oh, if it came today, I didn't look at it. So
I don't know if it came today. It came. There's a new warrant.
The last.
I don't know when it
came.
You
want me to open it up?
Yeah, the last warrant I saw, I looked, all of these things were in it.
Just
okay.
I feel like I looked at it last week, maybe.
Okay.
And
the.
That could change.
From
though,
the 22nd is the last one I have.
Yeah, and I think they're all in that one.
Okay.
That's the last one that I saw.
And the Capital Planning Committee is, I was just looking at my calendar.
Was,
I thought it's
that was in there.
10-3, I think.
That's what I yes.
That's
so I think that the schools are on the Capital Planning Committee agenda for next Monday,
yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Next Monday, where we'll go and talk about these items.
Yeah, okay.
Could I speak that a little bit to update you what's tra- transpiring on our end too. It's our responsibility as the select board to fund every operating budget and warrant article. And if all of that got funded, it would be about $15 million.
Yep.
We're talking about all the buildings, and that would a little bit more than double Hadley's tax rate.
Mm-hmm.
And that's figuring at 8.6 cents per million, and that comes out a little over $27 per million for each average home in town. So we're being asked Wednesday at our select board meeting to make recommendations on all these warrant articles. It's kind of difficult for us. We were hoping we would have the recommendations from the Finance Committee and Capital Planning. We're putting the cart before the horse, in my opinion, but how it works out, I guess. You know, but that's the way it's aligned right now. And our town administrator, our treasurer, and our financial analyst came in last week to try to put this all together. This puzzle is so difficult, people don't have any idea how difficult this is, and we're not even close to doing that. I don't even know if we'll be close on October 20th, the way it looks right now, they're telling me. So there's maybe even a possibility that town meeting could be postponed again. That's what I was told by the treasurer this morning. So until we have enough time to pull it all together to make it work. So.
Well, we should definitely clarify that we're not asking for $500,000.
Yes. I did tell the Capital Planning Committee that at their first meeting.
So what I could use assistance with on thank you for getting the air conditioner quote. Do we want to go in with a moderate chance of being successful at getting half of them, or a low chance of getting all of them? And is that a fair way to assess the situation, right? If it's on town warrant, we ask for $400,000. Given what Mr. Pipchinski just said, is asking for $400,000 going to be too much given the other asks? Because when I spend time at the elementary school, and if I'm wrong, you know, I think you could parse it out where you could do half of the building, the half that gets hotter faster, frankly. Mm-hmm. It's not optimal, but it's better than nothing, definitely. And then maybe we come back again and look for them.
Now, was Hopkins Academy updated from the renovation grants, the splits we have in here? Or was that done with other money? I wasn't around when that happened. I don't know.
I don't remember. It was in my
I know a lot was done with the renovation grant, and I didn't know if that was included in it or not. But that's what we're talking about, things like that for elementary school,
right?
And Richard, maybe you could take a picture of that, of the ducks up there, so people know what we're, oh good.
Yeah.
I appreciate, so they at least know what we're talking about. The type of air, they're heating and air conditioning both, right?
Yeah,
correct.
Right. And I think the newer ones are even smaller.
And they work tremendously well.
Newer ones are much smaller and much more efficient.
Mm-hmm. In answer to your question, how about that, Annie and I will both be going to the Capital Planning Committee meeting next Monday.
Okay.
You all are welcome to go too. Why don't we get a sense of how that meeting goes? And
that'd be great. I'd like to go.
Okay. 5:30, Town Hall, Selectman's Meeting Room, next Monday.
And Linda, I may be missing it, but I don't see for the fields, the only reference to that in here is from the CPA.
That's all it will be.
Right. Good.
Do we need to ask for 15 if they're asking for 15?
No, is just for our planning purposes, and the fact that it's in a separate article from CPA is all we need for that. We don't need it in this table that you're looking at.
Okay, so we have the technology pieces and the air conditioners in this.
Yes.
And the $75,000 restoration is in the, I think it's the omnibus part.
Yeah, that's in
Article 1.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
I guess some examples what you're happening, DPW on their wish list would like a new building too. But they felt their infrastructure for the town is more important than a building, so they're holding off maybe for 5 years. Park and Rec has a great deal of money going into Zaterka Park, so they're holding off on a building too, which is a lot better than five departments want them all at once. Three is a little easier than five to deal with.
I feel like we just did the Finance Tri-Board report. Unless you have something to add. Do you have anything to add?
From the forum?
You want to mention the forum? Yeah.
The forum, I heard fabulous reviews about the school presentation, Annie.
Well, perhaps I'll take that show on the road. I'm sure that HBO would want to run a special.
I don't know why they wouldn't. That was,
well,
there's
I'm
nothing
not here
more.
Next week.
Who's going to play you in the movie?
I think the forum went pretty well, and I think that we did a good job of explaining how the school budget is looking now and into the future, and the challenges that we and the town face.
I was wondering whether, just because I haven't looked, Annie, if our slide deck and the one-pager handout that you had, whether that's posted on our site.
On our district website?
Right.
Let me double check.
Okay.
I think it is, but I'll make sure it is otherwise.
They were, especially the one-pager was a really good kind of compilation of information about the district.
Mm-hmm. Anything else on that? Capital?
One comment again. I think it went so well because Dr. McKenzie's insertion of humor in her. She had people laughing during her thing, and it would have been a very boring night otherwise, but she woke up people with her presentation.
Yeah.
And I tried to be so serious.
That's right. Capital, we've talked about facilities, grounds, anything else?
Just to say thank you to the CPA committee for authorizing, supporting us to go for $15,000 on the town warrant to what we're going to do is the money, if awarded, would go to get go out for bid for a new design for the fields, the Hopkins Fields. And assuming that the money does get funded, what we'd like to do is get some advisory committee, pull folks from the community as well as the schools, obviously, to sit down and talk about how best to do that. Mm-hmm.
So
break it out into the phases that are cost-effective, break it out into elements that maybe we can have volunteers assist with. We've got a lot of people from the community interested in helping us do things on the fields, and I think we could do a better job of designing that out to give people an opportunity to help.
That's great. And it builds off of some of the prior work that we've already had done, so
Definitely.
We don't lose that, but we gain the ability to phase this out over time and have those line items of volunteer work or volunteer contributions potentially.
Excellent. That's right, Heather. I mean, I think we do have an existing design. I think we need to update it. It's a few years old, but also it's one single design with a $1.2 million estimate that's years old. Given our financial situation, obviously we're not going to necessarily jump in and look for $1.2 million. What I think we need to do is break it out into two, maybe even three phases now and see what we can do in bite-sized chunks. They're doing that to good success. I think it's Sertica Park.
I guess the only thing we didn't say that we should say again is that at this point there is a forum to go over the town meeting warrant articles on October 20th with the fall town meeting to currently occur on 27th.
Yep.
And we would ask voters to support the replenishment of $75,000 to the school budget that was cut just before annual town meeting. And that, I believe, we decided was in Article 1 of the special town meeting warrant. So come, vote Article 1. Stay for the rest of the meeting. And I can't go to that forum. I think we've talked about this. I'm out of town on the 20th.
There's a possibility it might be rescheduled to the 19th because Molly Keegan isn't available on the 20th.
Oh.
Good to know.
Well, now I can go.
No.
And I don't know anything that's happening at CES, do you? We'll wait for next month on that. We've done our action items. Mm-hmm. People, it's 10 to 7. We just finished.
Yay.
Our next meeting is October 24th here in the music room of Hopkins Academy at 5:30.
I will be absent. I apologize.
I'll be here.
I'm happy to call in if you need a person.
Thank you.
Thanks. All right.
I guess we need a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Seconded.
Thank you. Excellent.
Yay.
We're all, I'm sure. Are we all in favor of that?
We are.
So.
Aye.